We're at the Mumbai First Summit that is looking at the possibilities of making Mumbai into a mega city and taking some chapters or some learnings from the European Union as well. Well, our next guest now is someone who spent over 35 years in actual active service. He knows what it is like to work at the ground level, the grassroots level, at the problem of governance that we so often discuss. We have Mr. B.C. Khatua, who is retired, of course, from the Indian Administrative Services, and he's now part of his own think tank, the Mumbai Transformation Support Unit. So it's great to have you here and be able to talk. You know, the one common issue that's really come out over this conference and over several others as well is that there is no cohesiveness in the approach to planning and execution when it comes to Mumbai, that there are lots of different agencies, sometimes working in different directions. You've spent about 7-8 years, right, in different, you know, civic capacities with different civic bodies within the city. So what would you say, are some of these allegations true? Is it right that civic agencies are not active enough?
Well, it is largely true that the governance structure of delivering civic services in Mumbai and metropolitan region is fragmented. No doubt about that. You look at the transportation services, it's provided by MMRDA, it's provided by MSRDC, to some extent it's provided by MCGM and other municipal bodies. You take housing, then also you have MADHA, you have SRA, you have the MMRDA, again BMC to some extent. So you have multiple agencies delivering same kind of services in fragmented parcels. So that doesn't lead to a very, very cohesive and comprehensive strategy and approach. That's been a big challenge. But these are historical developments which, one can't really wish away in one go. And that's the reason why in our phase 3 World Bank support program in MTSU, we have taken up these very issues of, this fragmented nature of handling housing and urban governance, and how to bring some kind of cohesiveness and some kind of integration in this process. And hopefully these studies also throw up some insight into the strategy that we can adopt for the future.
Well, one always talks about transport, and that seems to be a real core issue which is close to the average Mumbaikar, and of course a lot of that we've heard in the conference as well. What are the first steps? I mean, it's a basic problem. Why can roads not be
fixed? Well, we must understand first the limitations and constraints that this megacity faces. To begin with, the Mumbai city as such is bounded by sea on three sides. As you know, a major part of the city owes its origin to the reclamation of land. And being a narrow north-south corridor, it has limited road spaces.
One understands that, but one is talking about the upkeep and management of existing major roads.
I'm coming to that.
Yeah.
Now when you have, I was trying to contextualize the
peculiar managing problem managing of the issue. Mumbai. Yes.
Because you are constrained and bounded by your physical limitations.
Right.
And since Mumbai has these peculiar limitations, which is not the case with many other megacities, which can expand on all sides at free will, literally. So obviously, when you provide for various traffic solutions, they are constrained by this very physical limitation and constraint. Of late, the city has witnessed a very rapid growth in the acquisition of personal vehicles. It both owes partly to the growing prosperity among the younger generation into new jobs and opportunities and earning better, living better, and therefore aspirational value of acquiring a personal transportation. The second aspect, which is perhaps to my mind is more important, is that our public transport services have of late deteriorated both in terms of quality and in terms of quantity vis-a-vis the demand. Now consequently, Mumbai, which was priding itself in having 86% of the commuters relying upon
public transport
say about 20 years back, it's come down to less than 80%. And while the percentage fall may be only 6%, but in actual numbers, it works out to very gigantic number.
That's many more cars and more motorists on the road.
And when you translate that into personalized vehicles, the road space occupied by personalized vehicles for that 6% extra, plus the natural growth of population, obviously adds to a very significant number of new vehicles on the road.
But that's because existing public transport, while it's good compared to other cities, has not been enough to keep up with the demand.
It is both not enough as well as not really good. If you look at the suburban train lines, train services.
It's not a simple experience to travel by the train.
It's very efficient in its own way.
Yes.
But It is so crowded, so congested, and so dangerous for people to travel.
Absolutely.
Sometimes hanging onto the bars on the doorstep.
It's not a dignified
way. This is not a very dignified way of travel.
Yes.
And certainly you are not very sure that you will be able to get a seat on the next train. And that's not a very happy
situation. Or even
situation.
Dignified standing space. Yeah.
And similarly, on the road transportation or the public transport, that is BST buses. BST at one time was a very efficient service provider. And was carrying almost 4 million people every day, let's say about 15 years back. Mm. Unfortunately, in spite of adding at least 25% more buses, the number of passengers carried today is almost the same, which means its efficiency has gone down
right.
in terms of kilometers covered by each vehicle and the number of turnarounds that a vehicle can do per day because of the heavy congestion on the roads.
Mm-hmm.
So both the increase in the public private transport and deterioration of public transport literally feed into each other. More public private transport, more congestion on the road,
sure.
more deterioration in the public transport.
Well, the answer perhaps then supposed to be was something like the Mumbai Metro, which hopefully we should get the first line soon. But it's all running behind schedule. There are too many delays.
Absolutely, absolutely. Mm. In fact, if you look at the public transport and its improvement, scope for improvement, we have to look at both metro as well as the suburban services, as well as the monorail also, which is coming up. But these three taken together, are they likely to solve the problem in the near future?
Mm.
My answer is no, because metro as it is very cost intensive, very time consuming, and in the context of Mumbai's congested roads, building overhead metro lines is not easy. The 12 kilometers have taken a big toll on everybody's patience and resources to put it on in place, and hopefully it will be operationalized in the next couple of months. But with this kind of time frame, the 9 corridors that we have planned for the city will take ages, and by then one can't really imagine how the city situation would be.
Mm.
The monorail program in any case is limited only for the very congested roads where metro cannot be put in place. So to my mind, the solution lies in expediting the metro program and taking a major part of it underground.
Right.
While underground may cost a little more than the overground metro, but in the long term it will serve the city better.
Sure.
It will create less chaos and confusion in the present during construction.
Mm-hmm.
And the only time it will be disrupting the overground traffic or the public conveniences would be only when they have to puncture the ground to bring the accessibility to the ground from the underground station.
Sure.
So therefore, I would be very happy if the Metro 3 also comes up very fast.
Mm-hmm.
But given the kind of investment that we are talking about, 20,000, 30,000 crores for each line, so we are looking at almost more than 2 lakh crore investment for these 9 metro lines,
right.
and probably a timeline of a very conservative timeline of 15 years and perhaps more liberal and realistic time frame of 20 to 25
years.
Now I can't imagine how the city will be 25 years. So therefore I would strongly say that we have to improve the suburban services, add more lines to the extent possible, increase the number of buggies in each train, and to the extent possible also expedite the inter-train time intervals.
Perhaps you need a bigger and more drastic reform process.
But to add to all that, I would say we have a reasonably good short to medium term solution in terms of BRTS, that is bus rapid transit system, which unfortunately at this point of time cannot be implemented in the island city because of the limited road space. But the suburban roads, especially the two expressways, and the east-west connectors, at least the two of the connectors, if not all of them, can easily be connected together with a part of the Thane road space.
Perhaps the time for token change
And we can create a BRTS network of about 116 kilometers.
Right.
We have already done a preliminary study on that. We have invited some experts from Colombia and the Embark and other agencies to find out the feasibility.
Sure.
They have assured us that is feasible and we can invest not more than 20-25 crores per kilometer, as again 250 crores to 300 crores per metro kilometer.
Right.
And we can get this going within 3 to 5 years' time.
What finally, what message or what suggestion would you like to give to those who are heading the municipal corporation right now or the commissioner of the MMRDA? Because you've been in, you know, different roles, you know how the constraints work, but being a Mumbaikar, what do you think is the need of the hour?
Now, as I said, whatever infrastructural investment programs we have for metro and monorail, etc., let them be expedited to the extent possible.
Right.
But that apart, we must necessarily go for BRTS wherever it is feasible,
okay,
and create a network.
Is better execution possible than how we are executing projects?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes, because the metro one, the lessons that we have seen through our studies, is that we could have managed it in a better time frame. It could have been managed with less inconvenience to the public, and definitely at a relatively lesser cost. Because we must always remember that time is money.
Sure.
More the delay, the more the cost.
Well, we hope lessons have been learned, and hopefully the newer projects will move more quickly. Thank you so much.
Thank you.